all of you here today, and we're looking forward to what God has in store for us on this special Sunday, the week before Easter. And let's grab our hymn books and get started. Turn to 500, "When the Roll is Called Up Yonder," 500. Let's all stand and sing the first and last verse.
"When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, teachers today. Pray you'll save the lost. In Jesus' name. Amen. Anybody have a birthday this week? Birthday. Any anniversaries this week? Oh, anniversary back. How many years, sir?
51.
51. Abigail, are you down to a hug? I appreciate your honesty. Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21. That's a solid job there. They don't know what we did. This is the beginning of a special week, and these verses will be talking about that. Matthew 21, verses 8 through 11. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way.
And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
And when he was come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this?
And the multitude said, This is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee.
This is Palm Sunday. Palms actually represents goodness and victory, which is symbolic of what Jesus was about to accomplish that week. He was definitely going to have victory, wasn't he? Yeah. And what did he ride in on? A donkey. In those days, donkeys symbolized peace. Like, I come in peace. Kings would ride in on donkeys. Jesus didn't ride in on a big horse like the Roman legions would have back then. The Romans had no good intentions. Jesus came in peace, which is symbolic. And when they shouted, Hosanna, that word Hosanna means to save now. Save us now. Jesus wept for this city. He knew these same people who were cheering for him at that moment was about to do what? Betray him. Crucify him. So, Palm Sunday is very important, very, very important day for Christians. And as we go through this week and next Sunday at Easter, Satan, our enemy, knows how grateful we should all be. And he wants to do things in our lives to make us forget that fact. He'll do stupid things, won't he? Like next Sunday morning, if the sausage gravy isn't thick enough, some people may complain about it. I don't think any of us would, but that's the kind of stupid thing Satan does. Sure. Let's just remember this time of year how grateful we should be for the sacrifice Jesus made for us. Yeah. Be thankful that he came riding in on that donkey to save us from our sins. Let's stand and say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I was listening to a guy preaching on the radio. It's down in North Carolina someplace. And it was a Mount Zion Gospel Radio Hour or something like that. And this guy was preaching, and I got to listen to him. And he was one of those people who had this rhythm when he preached. You know what I'm talking about? If you don't want to go to hell, you got to get saved, you got to put your faith in Jesus Christ, And I listened to him for about 5 minutes. I thought, you reckon that guy's going to stop and take a breath anytime? So, but you know, a lot of the preachers who preach like that are older preachers now. And I enjoy listening to them. Now, it's one of them things where you can kind of take it, and I don't mean it's a bad way, but you can kind of take it in small doses, you know? I mean, I enjoy the way our preacher preaches, but at a revival or something like that, I enjoy listening to those guys. And the amazing thing about them is when you listen to them, and we had a guy, it's been several years ago, that came in here and did that. They'll get up and preach, and when they get up to preach, all they got is their Bible. That's it. They open their Bible, they read the scripture, and they start. No notes. You know, they're not saying, well, turn to this page, turn to that page, I mean, they are steady rolling. And they can do it for an hour. I mean, I think that's amazing. I'll tell you what. You go on this week and find your favorite scripture in the Bible. Come in here next week. We'll let you stand up here and hold your Bible and talk for 45 minutes. See how that works. Right? It's hard. That's amazing that they do that. But it's good to listen to him, and I enjoyed listening to this guy. If you ever get a chance, there's a man named Maze, M-A-Z-E, Maze Jackson. Go to YouTube, type in Maze Jackson. He's got a sermon on there about burning the barley fields, if you ever get an opportunity. He's one of these guys. Opens his Bible, starts, preaches for an hour, hour and 15 minutes. It's but it's good stuff. I mean, this is fire and brimstone, turn or burn, you know, it's right on the money. And it's interesting to listen to. Okay, here we go. Let's pray and we can start. Father, we thank you so much for this day. We just praise you, Lord, and give you the glory for this wonderful time of the year. Thank you for helping us and loving us and everything that you've done for us, for our church. We thank you most of all, Father, for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Pray that you be with us this morning, just guide us through our lesson. Have the Holy Spirit lead us so we can learn, just learn to come closer to you, to abide in you. Thank you for saving us, for the forgiveness of our sins. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Okay, take your Bibles, turn to the book of Exodus, chapter 12. Exodus, chapter 12. Danny, you got visitors back there, is that right? That's your mother and father? Is that right? Glad y'all are here. You came from Ohio, is that right? I wouldn't tell anybody that. I just let that go. Nah, I'm kidding. We're glad. Where are you from in Ohio? Massillon. Yeah, I know where Massillon's at. How far is that from Columbus?
About 2 hours, 2.5 hours north of.
Really? Well, that's good. That might come in handy. We all go to Columbus in the fall on a mission trip. We just come up and stay a few. You can feed us, you can give us a place to sleep. We just roll right in there. Okay. I'm glad you're here. It's good that you're all here. It's good to see you all. I'm sorry. Bethany? She's with you?
Yes. Hi.
Hey, it's good to see you. Glad you're here. Okay, Exodus chapter 12. Now, what I want you to think about here for a little bit, and this is, it was kind of hard for me, I guess. Exodus chapter 12, we'll look at verse number 1. We're getting ready to talk about the Passover. Now, before we start into this, there's a couple of things here that we need to understand. And this is what we're working towards here with what we're going to talk about today and what we're going to talk about next Sunday. This is the whole crux of what we believe. All right? We're right here in the thick of it. Okay? When you talk about how we get saved and what we believe and why we get saved, here it is. Okay, this is what we're getting ready to do. And this is important. This is really important. This Passover service, supper, that we're getting ready to look at is, this is where the preacher always starts squirming. It is the most important event that happened in the Old Testament. All right, bar none. This is the most important thing. The reason being, and there was a lot of important stuff that happened in the Old Testament. I mean, you got the Red Sea, you got Daniel on the lion's den, you got Gideon, you got the flood, right? This Passover is the clearest picture of how we get saved and why we are saved in the Old Testament. Now, there are pictures of Christ in the Old Testament. Moses is a picture of Christ, the ark is a picture of Christ. This is the clearest, most definite thing that we can look at in the Old Testament that shows us what we believe. Okay? Now, the interesting thing about this is this happened 4,000 years ago. Okay? This wasn't like last week. 4,000 years ago, God caused this event to happen and gave us the opportunity now to look back at it and say, oh, I understand. Now I understand what's going on here. Okay? I don't think when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, I don't think they understood it. Now they were beginning to be led into understanding, but they didn't have the opportunity that we have to look back at that and to see the parallels between what happened then and where we are. Okay? We have to understand, with these children of Israel, what started with 70 people, okay? 70 starving people went into the land of Egypt simply trying to survive. They were looking for something to eat. That's why they went into Egypt, okay? 430 years later, 1 million people come out of Egypt, out of slavery, out of bondage, into freedom in one night. That's amazing, you know? 430 years from 70 people to 1 million people, okay? Out of bondage into slavery. Now, I just lost it. Wait a minute. Now, the reason for this is, and there's two reasons here. This is what we need to remember. This is where it starts to come to us, okay? They come out of this bondage, and they came out of this slavery because of the grace of God and a promise to Abraham. That's the entire reason. That's why this whole thing happened. The grace of God and a promise to Abraham. Okay? That's what brought these people out of the land of Egypt. Now remember, the most important thing that happened. Okay? Alright, take your Bible. Look at verse number 1, chapter 12, verse number 1. It says, "And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be unto you," now watch this, "the beginning of months, and it shall be the first month of the year to you." Alright? First month of the year to you. God told Moses right here, and this is why this is the most important event. God told Moses right here, stop, hold everything right here. We're starting over again right here. First day of the month, first day of the year, here we are. First month, we're starting again. This is, see, here's where it comes to us again. This is a new beginning, all right? A new beginning starts right here for these children of Israel. Now, so the calendar, the Jewish calendar, today, 4,000 years later, is centered around that, all right? All right, you ready? Ready? Girls, ready? What's our calendar centered around? What is our calendar centered around?
Pagan.
Nope. Okay. No one says? Ready? Now we got a lot of people here, so there's no pressure. Alright? This is the year 2021. It has been 2021 years since what? Please, North Sue. 2021. Help her, Corey. Help her. Come on. 2021 years. What? Birth of Christ. Yeah, it's been 2020. Our calendar is centered around the birth of Christ. Mercy goodness. All right? 2021 years. Right there in the New Testament, the virgin birth. Remember we were talking about the virgin birth last week? The greatest sign that God ever gave to mankind. The virgin birth is the most important event that happened in the New Testament. All right? Passover in the Old Testament, virgin birth in the New Testament. You do understand that without the virgin birth, there would have been no cross.
That's right.
Right? All right? The cross wouldn't have been given if it hadn't been for the virgin birth. The most important, at the new beginning, our calendar is centered around the birth of Christ. Okay? Now, let's take a minute and talk about, this is interesting. When the children of Israel left Egypt, that was the first Exodus. This was the Exodus from Egypt, right? You do understand there's going to be a second Exodus, right? Now think about that a minute. There is going to be a second Exodus. We are going to participate in this second Exodus, right? Whether we participate in it from the heaven side or whether we participate in it from this side, we are going to be in it because we're saved. Now, if you're sitting here this morning, and I don't mean to be blunt, but here it is. If you're not saved, then you're not going to participate in this Exodus.
That's right.
Okay? What do we call that? What do we call this Exodus?
Rapture.
Rapture. All right? That's the rapture. Right? After the rapture, we'll talk about this in just a second. After the rapture, there's the judgment. Right? That's bad. Right? Second Exodus, the rapture. Okay? Now, let's look at what's going on here for a minute. Take the Bible and turn over to verse number 12. Verse number 12. Same chapter. Verse number 12. Alright? The calendar's changed. Now, the children of Israel have been in Egypt for 430 years, right? God's getting ready to take them out of Egypt. How many, you know about the plagues, right? Plagues that God put on the children of Egypt. How many were there?
Ten.
There were ten, okay? The last one is the one we're going to talk about. The last one is where God kills the firstborn of the people of Egypt. Let me tell you something so you know this, all right? And I heard Richard Harper say this, and it's been some time ago. He was preaching here on this. God did, and this is what Richard Harper said, God did not farm this job out to somebody else, right? This is God we're talking about, who went through the land of Egypt, who killed the firstborn of every Egyptian, all right? It wasn't anybody else. It was God, right? Now, 10th plague, firstborn of all the children. What was the plague before the 10th one? What was the 9th one? What? Darkness. Now you need to go back and look at this. This is going to be important next week. All right. The plague before the last one, the next and last one, was darkness. Okay, 3 days of, and we're talking the real deal, dark. Okay. All right. So God is going to go through the land. God is going to tell Moses, I'm going to kill the firstborn of all the children. That's what's getting ready to happen. Now, because of this plague, Pharaoh and the people of Egypt are going to say, all right, go, get. You know, we've had enough of you. Take everything we got and go. All right? That's what happened. They don't just say, well, you might be able to leave now. They say, please get your stuff and go. All right? Now, the land of Egypt is condemned. All right? They're living at this time, they're living under condemnation. All right? Now let me explain to you what that means a little bit. They had an opportunity somewhere through these plagues, through these signs and wonders, through everything that happened. The people of Egypt had an opportunity to turn to God and say, I believe, you know,
right. Yep.
I'm putting my faith and trust in you. They didn't do it. They had a choice. We talked about this before. Everybody that's in hell is there because that's where they chose to be.
Sure.
All right? These people of Israel, these people of Egypt, they had a choice. They didn't take it. Now, they're under this condemnation. Okay? What happens after condemnation is judgment. That's what's getting ready to happen to these people of Israel. God's judgment. All right? God is the one that's going to execute his judgment on these people. Okay? Now, think about this. This judgment is going to be universal, right? Everywhere in Egypt. That means the man who's living up in the mountain on the far corner of the country that don't know nothing about what's going on here, that has a son that's 12 years old that was his firstborn, he's going to lose that son, okay? All over the country, it's universal, and it's fatal, A lot of people, a lot of people are going to die here because of this. Okay? Now, let's stop. Here is where we need to begin to put this together a little bit. All right? Think about our country. Think about the world we're in today. All right? You understand that the world that we live in today is condemned. Right? Everybody understands that. Take your Bible. Turn to the book of John. Look at John chapter 3. Look at John chapter 3 and look at verse number 17. John chapter 3, verse number 17. It says, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world." God didn't send, Jesus Christ didn't come into the world to condemn the world, because the world's already condemned. Right. It was condemned before he ever got here. And it is condemned today. Remember, and we talked about this sometime back. Remember Adam? Remember? By one man, sin entered into the world. Remember that? Right there is where the condemnation came from. That's why we are condemned. Okay? Now, the good news is me and you are not condemned. But the world in general is condemned. The next thing that's going to happen because of this condemnation, just like Egypt, because of this condemnation, now comes the judgment. All right? Here he comes. He says, tomorrow. All right? And when this judgment comes, what we're talking about for this judgment, when we talk about the judgment that we're going to receive, what are we talking about? When's this going to happen? Okay, let me start again. This is going to happen during the tribulation. The tribulation is going to be God's judgment on the world. Jesus Christ's wrath on the world. That's when it happens. What happens right before that is the second Exodus. Okay? That's when we leave. We're gone. All right? Then that judgment is going to happen. And that judgment is going to be just like the judgment that we're talking about here. It's going to be universal. It's going to be worldwide. And a lot of people are going to die because of it.
Sure. All
right? Okay, now, let's think about this just a minute. Take your Bibles and turn, look back at verse number 3, same chapter. Exodus chapter 12, verse number 3. And we're going to look at verse 3 through 11. What we're going to talk about here next is, I mean, you understand what's getting ready to happen, all right? What we're going to talk about is the lamb, all right? God gives Moses a set of instructions that will protect the children of Israel, the same as God gave us a set of instructions that will protect us. Now, let's talk about this lamb for just a second. What he tells him, God tells these people, tells Moses, go tell them, they need to go find a lamb. Alright? This lamb needs to be a year old. And here's the important part, it needs to be without blemish. We're talking without blemish. What these people have to do is find a perfect lamb. Alright? Perfect. Perfect. That's important, and that's not that easy to do. No blemishes. Okay? Now, God also tells him, he said, you can use a lamb or you can use a goat, sheep or goat. All right, Bible trivia. Here we go. Ready? How many? There are five clean animals in the Old Testament that can be used for sacrifice. One of them is a sheep, one of them is a goat. That's why God told them, you can use a sheep, you can use a goat. Okay? There are three more animals. All right? What are they? Tell me one. Bull, cow, yeah. Oxen. All right, there's one. Now, what? We got a sheep and a goat and cattle. What?
Turtle.
Turtle dove. Good. I didn't think y'all know this. There's one more. Come on. What?
Pigeon.
Yeah. Thank you, Pam. Pigeon, turtle dove, ox, sheep. Oh, he told you. All right. Sheep, goat, Turtle dove, pigeon, oxen. All right, so anyhow, they go to look for this lamb. Now, what they're supposed to do with this lamb, now think about this a minute. This is the first day of the first month, all right? God said, you got 10 days to find this lamb, all right? And they're going to need it. We're talking a perfect lamb, okay? 10 days. You remember, Byron, when he opened your window, he was talking about Palm Sunday? Remember Christ rode into Jerusalem on the donkey? Remember that? Palm Sunday? Okay. The lamb, they were to take it into their house on the 10th day of the month. That's what God told them. You got 10 days to find it. On the 10th day, take it into your house. Jesus Christ rode the donkey into Jerusalem on the 10th day of the month.
Sure.
All right? That was a Sunday. There, see this? 10th day of the month. All right? Then God tells them, all right, take this lamb on the 14th day and kill it. All right? Take it and kill it. Now, what they were going to, oh, by the way, Christ is crucified on the 14th day of the month. Same day, same thing, same time span. All right? Now, take the lamb. You're going to cook the lamb. You've got the lamb. You're going to have unleavened bread. You're going to have bitter herbs. And somewhere along the line, they brought in wine or grape juice, however you want to go with that. All right? So, you've got the lamb. You've got the bitter herbs. You've got the unleavened bread. And you've got the wine. Now, we'll get back to that in just a minute. Okay? He says, kill a lamb on the 14th day of the month. Now, here comes the important part. And here's where it begins to really affect us. Look at look over verse number 13. Okay? You see there in verse 12, where you finish up in verse 12, it says, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. You know, I was reading this, and I was thinking about this a little bit. Every time I see that in the Bible, I get this little squirrely feeling right back here. Okay? I am the Lord. It's like a little chill. All right? Remember when we were talking about the book of Amos? All right? And God was telling the Egyptians, I did this, you didn't return to me. I did this, you didn't return to me. I did this, you didn't return to me. And then he said, prepare to meet thy God.
Yeah.
Right? There's that little ooh, ooh, like ooh. You know? Okay, well, skip that. All right, doesn't matter. All right, here we go. The blood. Now, this is where it really begins to tie into us. All right? God told Moses, tell them to take that blood and put it on the doorpost. Now, they put it on this door. If it was this door right here, they put it here, right here, they put it right here, they put it right there. Now, believe it or not, I started to bring a big can of red paint in here, slap red paint on that door, so y'all have a visual thing. And I thought, preacher ain't gonna like this. So there went the red paint. All right. Put the blood on the door. Now, this is important. And this is important for us. All right? They put this blood on this door. Now, God didn't say, you have to put the blood on the door. God said, tell them to put the blood on the door. They got a choice right there. First of all, they don't even have to go find the lamb. You know, it's up to them. The blood, kill a lamb, put it on the door. There's choice number two. And nobody's going to put that blood on that door for them.
Right.
All right, they got to do it themselves. Moses is not going around the community with a thing full of blood putting it on everybody's door. They have to do it themselves. There's their choice. God also tells them, and I think it's in verse 22, do not come outside. All right, while this is going on, stay in the house. All right, there's choice number three. They were more than welcome to go outside and wander around while all this is going on. They didn't have to put the blood on the door, like the man said. They had a choice. Alright? Now, you do understand what would have happened if they didn't have the blood and if they did go outside and wander around. Alright? They would immediately have become part of the condemned people and they would have faced the judgment of God. Alright? Now, that's all I need you. But I want you to stop and think just a minute about. Let me back up. Back up. So we'll take your mind, turn to the book of John. The book of John. Book of John, chapter number one. Book of John, chapter number one, verse number 29. Chapter chapter 1, verse number 29. It says, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold the Lamb of God. All right? Now, right there is Christ the Lamb. Okay? John the Baptist sees him and looks at him and says, behold the Lamb of God. All right? Now, go to 1 Corinthians. Go over to 1 Corinthians, chapter 5. And verse number, chapter 5, verse number 7. 1 Corinthians, chapter 5, verse number 7. George, you keeping up? All right. Okay, verse number 7 says, purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump. For as ye are unleavened, now here comes, all right, Christ, the Lamb, for even Christ, our Passover. Christ is our Passover.
Right.
Christ is the Lamb that is perfect without blemish. Christ is our Passover. Okay? You and I are covered by, just like the people of Israel were covered by the blood of that Lamb, you and I are covered by the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. It's as simple as that. Alright? We are, and the reason for this, remember we talked a few minutes ago about how the children of Israel were coming out of the land of Egypt because of God's grace and the promise they made to Abraham. All right? The reason that we are saved is because of God's grace and the promise that God made to us. All right? Same thing. It's the same thing. And that's all there is to it. God's grace and the promise that he made to us. Now, all of you all know John 3:16. Right? Right? George, you know, right? John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Right. Right here's the promise. Here's God's promise. Whosoever believeth on him shall not perish. All right. There is the promise that God gave us that gives us the opportunity to be under the blood of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Jesus Christ is the Passover Lamb. Jesus Christ is perfect. Blood, it's the same thing. All right. And I know you all can see that. I know you knew it before I started. It's the same thing that happened at Passover. All right? Same thing here. And we have the same choices. Okay? You don't have to get under the blood of Jesus Christ. You don't have to pay any attention to the cross. You don't have to pay any attention to God's promise. You can go out and wander around in the world all you want to. All right? And basically do whatever you want. You will end up the same place that these Egyptian people are going to end up when they face the judgment of God. You will face the judgment of God just like they did. You will end up the same place as they did. Okay?
Sure.
That's why, and now remember, that's why this is so important. Because God told us all of this 4,000 years ago. Alright? That's what makes it important. Okay? Okay, one more thing. We're about done. Go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. First Corinthians chapter 11. Just a minute, let me get caught up here. Look at verse number 24. Now, need to understand what's happening here. Alright? Christ and his disciples are at the Last Supper. Okay? Now, what they're doing at this Last Supper is celebrating the Passover meal. All right? God told them 4,000 years ago, you do this every once a year. Do it and do it from now on. All right? And the Jewish people, they're still doing it today. Okay? 4,000 years later. These disciples were getting ready to have the Passover meal with Jesus Christ. Okay? They killed the lamb. They got it. They had the unleavened bread. They had the wine. They had the bitter herbs. Okay? And they're having this Passover meal. Now, this is really important what happens here. Okay? They get ready to do this. Judas leaves. Alright? He's not going to do what he's going to do. Now, they're celebrating this Passover meal. And remember, these disciples, they don't understand. Now, they're beginning to understand, but they don't really understand yet. They haven't got it. They're getting ready to.
Mm-hmm.
Alright? Jesus Christ says, well, hang on. Okay? He stands up and he takes his bread, breaks it like this, and looks at his disciples and says, this is my body. All right? Do this in remembrance of me. Okay? Now, the next thing that happens is he takes the wine and says, this is my blood. Okay? Do this in remembrance of me. Alright? Now this is important. This is a big deal. What gave him the authority to stand up and say, okay, we're not doing Passover no more. You can forget that. Here's what I want you to do from now on. Alright? God said Passover forever. Alright? Christ said, nah, that's not what we're doing. Okay? Here's what I want you to do. I want you to do this bread, and I want you to do it in remembrance of me. I want you to do this blood, this wine, I want you to do this in remembrance of me. You don't have to worry about the Passover no more. Here, right here's where we are. And it says in those verses that this is the New Testament in his blood. Okay? This New Testament means promise. A new promise. Remember the promise? Whosoever believeth shall not perish. Alright? There's the promise. That's what we're talking about. This is God's new promise. Okay? Now, but still, what gives him the right to stand up and do this? To change everything that's been going on for the last 2,000 years. Alright? Do you remember? Now, you do understand that. You do understand that Peter couldn't have stood up and said, well, here's what we're going to do from now on. Alright? Nobody else could. Just Christ. The reason that he couldn't do this, the reason he had the authority to do this. Do you remember Christmas time? Remember that? Remember we were talking about who that was born in that manger? Remember that? Remember Emmanuel? Remember that? God with us? Okay? That's who we're dealing with here. That's what gives him the authority to stand up and say, I'm getting ready to change this. This is the ordinance that I want you to obey, and I want you to obey it from now on, just like I told you right here. All right? The reason that he has the authority to do that is because of who he is. That makes sense? Mm-hmm. Good? Answer. Good? Right. Now, here's the important part. Here's where we're going to stop. We're headed to the cross. All right? That's where all this is going. Everything that we've been talking about, everything that happened here in Jerusalem, now we're headed to the cross. Now, if you understand who he is and why he has this authority, now you begin to understand who it was that was actually on the cross. Mm-hmm. Okay? That's why it's important. All right? Y'all did very well. I am truly impressed. You did a nice job. You sat there and paid attention and just like, tell me. All right. Here's the big deal. You need to look at this. We're going to talk about the cross next week. All right? And this is the big finale. This is the big finish. All right? The cross is about everything that we believe is right there. All right? Everything that's going to get us to heaven, everything that we think about is right there. The cross and the blood of the cross. All right? And a preacher like ours could stand up here and talk about the cross for 10 weeks. I mean, there's so much stuff there.
Sure.
What I want you to look at, what you and I are going to talk about, is they need to look at this. Look closely in Matthew and Luke, maybe John, I'm not sure. Look at what Christ said while he was on the cross. All right? It's everything. Everything finishes right there in what he said. All right? He spoke on the cross, I think, 7 times. All right? Look closely at what he said. And the whole, it all comes together. Boom. Right there at the cross. Okay? Remember the darkness plague. Remember that? Next to the last plague. Alright? While he's on the cross, darkness comes. Alright? Everything changes. When the darkness comes, everything changes. Look at that closely. Alright? That's what we're going to talk about. Okay? Okay. Well, have you got anything?
Yes.
How about it?
Jesus said, I changed. We're going.
Yep.
Did he drink the blood, the wine, and did he break, did he eat the bread?
Did he eat the bread? No, we're good with wine, grape juice.
Yeah.
Okay.
I say he didn't.
Why?
Well, because everybody's always talking about Jesus turned water to wine, Jesus drank the wine, and they never says that Jesus drank the cup. The cup that they always are after, you know, the chalice that he drank from and all that. He never drank from it.
Well, all right. Now, before we go any further, does the Bible tell us?
I don't think so. I don't think it says anywhere.
So we're working with opinion here. And
why would you drink? If you was the sacrifice,
right.
Why would you drink and eat of your own sacrifice?
You're exactly right. So I wouldn't argue with that. I would think that's a good point that he did not drink the blood and he did not eat of the bread. All right, let me give you another piece of trivia here. This is good, and we'll be done. All right, you ready, Miss Pearl? You ready? Okay. The Jewish people have what's called the Feast of Unleavened Bread. The Feast of Unleavened Bread starts, some people say it starts on the 14th when Christ was crucified. Some people say it starts the next day after Christ was crucified. Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Jewish people, lasts for 7 days, okay? No leaven in their house for 7 days. You and I understand, we've talked about the fact that leaven represents sin, right? Okay, now think about this a minute. They say 7 days, that means no leaven. That doesn't mean a little bit, that means none. None. Okay? Now, how many of y'all got a toaster? Okay? How many of y'all got crumbs in the bottom of the toaster? There's leaven. There's leaven in that toaster. Oh, really? It's got to go. Okay? How many of you have a bread drawer? You got a bread drawer, bread box at home that you keep your bread in? Where do you keep your bread, Leroy?
I keep it in
the refrigerator. Okay. Okay, that's fine. But you understand that if you're keeping it in a bread drawer or keeping it in, there's crumbs in there, right? That's leaven. That's got to go. No leaven, all right? You can't have none. This is where spring cleaning came from. The Jewish people take everything out of their house and go in every nook and cranny. I mean, if you got a breadcrumb under the bed up here in this corner, you got to get it out. Everything comes out. Everything gets clean. Okay? Spring clean. You believe that?
First time I heard it.
Well, the part about the leaven is true, and they do that, and they're serious. These Jewish people, and I'm not talking bad about Jewish people at all. They're serious about this. This feast of the Passover, they still do it just exactly like it's been done, and they do it for the last 4,000 years. So, okay, next week we'll talk about the cross. Next week after that, of course, he's got some stuff for you. Yeah, that's pretty much that. Preacher, got anything? Anybody else? Okay. Mike, you want to pray? Then we'll be done.
Father, in this moment, I just want to feel our issue.